transmitted by wire.
Here is the latest news brought into your own living room.
You'll be hard to satisfy with anything less.
Let's give them something to talk about.
Talk is cheap.
Gib, gib, gib. Who is gossiping?
It's the John and Gordy Show.
This is Hi-Fi Plus.
And that's the way it is.
We'll do it live.
Only on Mad Radio 92.7 WMDX. Take it away, boys.
I love that. Do it live. Mad Radio. WMDX 92.7 FM 1580 AM on your magical radio dial if you still have one. And we also are on Civic Media, the app. Check us out there. You can call us very easily or text us very easily from that app, or go on social media as well and let us know what you think, or watch while you're driving. I know we're going to have a little disclaimer because this is a very dangerous situation. Yeah. We want to make sure that if people do watch and they do drive and they're listening on a Bluetooth radio in their car, I understand that there can be problems with that.
It could be a little confusing.
So we're going to have a little disclaimer eventually in regards to that.
Yeah, we got a meeting coming up on that.
Let's look at something that is going to be a national problem very soon. The Republicans like to create problems. They've created the problem at the border, and it's something they can run on. And I think maybe election after election after election, maybe they'll use the border, keep that border controversy and the crisis alive and well.
Yeah, well, might as well. Yeah.
They're creating a new problem, and that is statewide vouchers. Now, in Wisconsin, the Republicans wanted to go to a statewide voucher system. And everybody has a chance to go to a voucher school. And everybody gets a voucher, and they can spend it any damn way they want. And a lot of states have actually gone to a statewide voucher system. One of those states happens to be Arizona. And guess what? This is not turning out the way they should have thought, but they didn't think. Arizona taxpayers face a $400 million shortfall for their voucher program that they were told would only cost about $65 million. Well, now they're about $400 million short.
How did that happen?
And get this, the gap will be bigger next year. These programs aren't targeting the needy anymore, and that's the problem. More than half of voucher recipients are already in the private schools, and what they're doing, and they're wealthy, they're taking taxpayer money to pay for private schools, even though they could afford it, even though that was their choice to send their kids to these private schools. Supporters of school vouchers learned very quickly that the trick works just as well in education policy as it does in retail sales. Here's the trick. Pick a price that will get people in through the door, and then break the news once they've gotten into the store that maybe it'll cost a little bit more. In Arizona, taxpayers are now staring down a $400 million shortfall with an even bigger bill next year. Worse still, as spending on private school vouchers continues to exceed the projections, state treasuries are being emptied by tax cutting schemes. That's another thing, right? The Republicans here in the state are proposing another gigantic tax cut. Well, that's cutting into the money that they're going to need for the increasing shortfalls that will happen in a statewide voucher system. And thank God Governor Evers prevented a statewide voucher system from taking place in the state. But this is something that's going to just consume other states that have statewide voucher systems. And it's happening all across the country. These red states are still proposing statewide system voucher systems where taxpayers pay for all schooling and all the choices you want and all the choices you can have for spending that money. And we'll see. You know, now we're finding out these are the repercussions. This will be another gigantic problem that all these states will be facing. And it's another Republican-created problem that didn't have to happen. All we had to do, and by the way, I played a cut recently from a Michael Moore movie where he was in a Scandinavian country. I can't remember what it was, but he found out that they ban any public funding going to any private school. So there are basically hardly any private schools in that country. And here's the thing. Here's what they found. If you pair poor students with rich students, the rich student parents will make sure their kids get a great education, alongside those poor students. So it actually increases the education for both the poor and the wealthy. The wealthy are going to make sure their kids get the best education ever, and they're going to spend the money on that education, and the poor kids will be right alongside them. And that's how they managed to equalize education in that Scandinavian country.
Yeah, I think it was either Norway or Sweden, one of those. Yeah,
yeah,
That happened, and you're exactly right. Yeah, it helped helped everybody.
It did. Yeah. It did.
Way to do
it. Yeah, it sounds like a great idea, but we're going in the opposite direction. In fact, we have, and these red states have gone in the opposite direction by having a statewide voucher system where you could spend taxpayer money on any kind of educational policy you wanted to, especially even online education, which we find out is a devastating failure, but you can't convince anybody that this is all wrong, right?
Right.
All right. So,
phone lines are open, 608-879-8255. What do you think? You want to chime in? 608-879-8255. It's looking cloudy out there this morning, maybe rain later, highs in the mid-50s today. We might get an actual thunderstorm out of this. We're kind of downgrading that, but they were talking about storms yesterday for today. We'll see about that.
Well, you might have heard that Mike Gallagher, a representative up in the Green Bay area, he recently voted against impeaching Secretary Mayorkas. And the Republican Party now is not very happy with him.
Well, what are they going to do about it?
One Republican now has basically put forward a recommendation to Speaker Johnson that they should immediately remove Representative Gallagher from being the chair of the Chinese Communist Party Select Committee. Because out there. Yes, he's fighting communism, and that's the name of the committee. It sounds like they're for Chinese communism.
Yeah.
He's the chair of the Chinese Communist Party Select Committee. And boy, he might lose his chairmanship over not voting for the impeachment of Mayorkas.
Yeah, I think he was the deciding vote, or one of them.
Vote. They didn't have enough. Yeah, thousands of Chinese nationals are invading our nation because of the Biden-Mayorkas open border policy. It's not an open border policy, but if you keep telling the rest of the world that it's an open border, I guess we'll see more people trying to get here. Huh? You think?
Yeah.
God. Again, they're making the problem worse. And, you know, they're calling it an invasion and a crisis, and that's something that we could certainly do militarily if it is an invasion, but it isn't.
So this is tending to split the Republican Party right in half. It's just, it's happening right before our eyes. They're battling with each other on this thing because the border deal was pretty much a done deal in the Senate, and they'd been negotiating on it for months and months. And they thought they had a deal, and then Trump put the kibosh on that, and now it's all unraveling, and now there's a basic civil war inside the Republican Party.
There is. And it just keeps spreading and spreading. If you might remember the host of Capital City Sunday at Channel 27, A.J. Biaport was there for a while. Now he's back in Milwaukee. He had an interview recently with Brian Stile, an interview that did not go well for Brian. I just want to play a big part of this. Check this out. This is Brian Stile being interviewed about possibly never really helping Whitewater, who is experiencing an immigration problem there. Check this out.
Until you find some sort of agreement on there, or if this stretches all the way into November, there will be a need for resources in the eyes of the folks in Whitewater presently. Is there any effort, or are you planning to lead any kind of effort to secure federal resources for that community?
The answer here is to secure the U.S.-Mexico border. The president could do that today. That is priority number one, is forcing the president's hand to act to secure the border. H.R. 2 does just that.
So you're not going to push separately to get any resources to Whitewater?
AJ, I mean, in a serious sense, what exactly are you trying to pull out on this question? The state of Wisconsin is being challenged across the board in Whitewater and other communities to provide the resources that are needed because of the policies of this administration. This administration at the federal level, we should be working to make sure that we're securing the U.S.-Mexico border. The state and local level where these services are provided, they're being burdened by terrible policies by the president of the United States. At the federal level, I'm going to continue to advocate to make sure that we're securing the U.S.-Mexico border.
Yeah, that border.
Those are local leaders who are asking for federal resources. Not me. It's the local leaders who are asking for that. Why not address their request while continuing to push for border security?
Because it does nothing to solve the underlying problem. I'm working at solving the underlying problem, which is securing the U.S.-Mexico border and forcing the president of the United States to act. That is priority number one.
That is priority number one. You know, forget about the Whitewater civic leaders there trying to deal with the immigration problem that they have. You know, ignore that. Get to the underlying problem. So you don't really have to help them. So that's not really part of your agenda. That is not something you need to do. Just ignore Whitewater. You know, really concentrate. Focus. Please focus, Brian Style, on the Mexican border. That's where it all starts. If you can just cure that, oh, my gosh, then everything will work out in Whitewater, right? Yeah. Unbelievable stuff. Yeah.
Well, yeah. Something tells me even if they did that, those Whitewater would still have the problem. I mean, they're already there. You know, let's deal with the problem that's there. Help the local leaders. There's some, you can do something. You can provide some resources there.
Well, you know,
somebody's going to have to.
They keep talking about the fact that if Biden wanted to, he could close the border overnight, just like that, snapping his fingers. By the way, he offered that. Mm-hmm. If they passed the deal, he would have closed the border just like that, snapped his fingers, easily as that. It's not that easy. And Chip Roy, one of our favorite Republicans from Texas, chimed in on this. Check this out.
No, we're not going to just pass the buck and say that, oh, any president could walk in and secure the border. I saw former President Trump make that allegation earlier today on one of his social media posts. All a president has to do is declare the border is closed and it's closed. Well, with all due respect, that didn't happen.
No.
In 2017, 18, 19, and 20. There were millions of people who came into the United States during those 4 years. No, we're not going to just pass the buck and say that, oh, any president could walk in and secure the border. I saw former President Trump make that allegation earlier today on one of his social media posts. All a president has to do is declare the border is closed and it's closed.
Yep, that's it.
Well,
that's it.
With all due respect, that didn't happen.
He did not do it. All right.
Did not happen.
I'll let you know.
7:19. We're coming back.
At Radio WMDX 92.7 FM and 1580 AM, broadcasting from the capital city, Madison. We're hoping you're having a very good morning. That is theme music from a British spy thing. Well, it was called Pulaski the TV Detective. And I just love that show. And I thought the instrumentation is just fantastic. But anyway. He was an American playing a TV detective in a show, and then he'd take on real cases accidentally. And he was a notorious drunk as well. It was just
entertaining
a fun
show.
British humor, definitely. All right,
I love it. If you speaking of great music, and you were talking about the instrumental in that TV show, if you're looking for some music this evening, a jazz jam happening at Zuza Cafe. That happens at 5:30 on Thursdays. It's free. Just show up. Tony Castaneda, Latin jazz band, one of the great bands around. They are at the Cardinal Bar 5:30 this evening. And Noah James Hittner is at Harmony Bar and Grill at 6:45 this evening.
At the Harmony. At the Harmony.
Right. It's been a while since we've been there. We should stop in.
Well, I used to go there before it changed ownership. I haven't been there since, but they had great Cajun food at the time.
Oh, still a fun place and great acoustics there. Great venue, the Harmony.
Yeah. All right. We've got a story out of Tennessee again. Remember, I featured a couple of guys, black legislators in Tennessee, who were kicked out of their political jobs, and then they were immediately elected back in. Okay, and then that story was the fact that the Republicans are now creating a constitutional amendment to keep people from being reelected after being kicked out. And but it's not focused on those two guys who are black, okay?
Supposedly not focused on
them. And they were kicked out because they were protesting guns that the legislature in Tennessee did not want to do anything about the gun problem and children getting killed.
Right.
And these two legislators were protesting it, along with a white female legislator who didn't get kicked out. They kept her in, but they kicked out the two black legislators. Right. You can draw your own conclusions from that. Well, now that that white legislator, she's running for the U.S. Senate. And the Republicans down there are really not very happy about it. Here is Tennessee Representative Gloria Johnson, who's running for the Senate now. She's a representative down there in their assembly, and this is the way she tells it.
You know, these guys have been working for a long time to prevent me from serving my community, and my community keeps sending me back. They want to take away the voter's ability, again, to vote, send the person up here that they want to send. And, you know, the first time that a woman tries to run for two seats, it's a problem. You know, this has happened before and in the past, and it wasn't an issue, but it is now. It's really interesting that they are still, after they have refused to call on me for 45 minutes at a time as I raise my hand standing on the floor. They have put me in a closet and refused to give me a member office. They have brought expulsion resolutions against me, and they literally drew my block out of my precinct that I had lived in for more than 30 years to stop me from serving. And they will not be the decider for District 90. That'll be the people there. And this is just one more time of them throwing a fit. They are so triggered. And I just think that men are too emotional to govern.
There you go.
Wow. Drop the mic.
Man, wow. I mean, all the things that they have done against this female legislator.
Yeah.
And I just think this is happening everywhere. The total disrespect that's going on for women in politics is just outrageous. Look, I can even say, and this is a person I really, truly dislike a lot for policy, Rebecca Clayfish. She was running for governor. Mm-hmm. And as you may have noticed, she was edged out by the men. And she never noticed. She never knew that this is the boys' club kicking her out. It was just so blatantly boys club-ish that I'm surprised she never said anything about it. No resentment, none whatsoever. Mm-hmm. Got on board with the guy who kicked her out. It was just so obvious. And now we have this legislator, Tennessee Representative Gloria Johnson, given a closet. Not even an office. And they took her block, the place she lived, that block. They took it out of her district.
Right.
They are doing everything they possibly can. This is authoritarianism on steroids. And this is happening everywhere. Republicans feel this power at this point because I think Trump has opened the door for this kind of activity. This blatant in your face, we're going to do this no matter what. Sure, sue us, take us to court.
Right.
And now they have a lot of the judges and justices in these courts, so they can get away with a lot of this stuff. And I think Gloria Johnson, we'll see what happens, but she's a very strong individual. And she's right. You know, these guys are a little bit too immature to be in public office.
Yeah. This story today, a little closer to home, have you heard this? This came from WKOW. Wisconsin Attorney General Josh Call is joining a DACA coalition Of course, DACA, the Deferred Action for Child Arrival Program. This is a program that was going to take place and has been put off to the side. Well, Wisconsin Attorney General Josh Call joined a coalition of 23 attorneys mm-hmm. general across the country, filed with the U.S. Court of Appeals to appeal a U.S. District Court in Texas, their decision threatening to end the DACA program. Now, since 2012, more than 825,000 immigrants have been granted DACA status. And according to the U.S. Citizenship and Immigration Services, they report that 578,000 people were actively enrolled in that program in 2023. There are 6,000 DACA individuals residing in Wisconsin. So Josh Call's doing what he can, joining this coalition to fight this case in Texas. This is not going to be resolved anytime soon, but they're banding together to get on with this program. It's a program, it's a win-win for everybody, especially the DACA children that are now grown-ups and in our society and working good jobs, most of them, and just need some help to be able to do more. They're dreamers. A lot of cases, they already are in here as teachers and lawyers, and it's time to move forward on the DACA program.
Generally, they're just millennials.
Yes. You know,
they've grown up here. They've gone to school here. They've gotten jobs here.
And they came as kids, you know.
For kids of immigrants who came here illegally. But mm-hmm. They're the kids. And why we can't come to an agreement on this, it wasn't even included, by the way, in the recent House agreement that they turned down. They didn't even bring it up.
729 news, sports, and weather straight ahead. And coming up, Trump decrees Bud Light beer is good again. That story. Yeah. Oh, kids.
We'll be right back to the action right after this message.
This portion of the show is being brought to you by Ed's Heavy Beer, the beer for drinkers who just don't get enough calories in their regular beer. Ed's Heavy Beer has so many calories that you'll gain 15 pounds just from blowing off the foam.
Mad Radio WMDX 92.7 FM.
Maybe you need Bud Light, you know? Bud Light's coming back again now.
It's coming back in a big way.
Why? How did this happen?
One guy on Twitter X pointed it out. He said, incredible, after leading a year-long right-wing boycott of Bud Light, Trump says that the company deserves a second chance. Why? Their top lobbyist is hosting a fundraiser for Trump, and it turns out he owns $5 million in Anheuser-Busch stock. So Trump, you know, do I own that?
Non-president, he's given a pardon to Bud Light, right?
Yes, pretty much. Yeah, right. As non-president, okay. he has a lot of control for not being president.
I know he does.
That's amazing. This is on Truth Social. Here's his tweet there, whatever it is, Truth Social post. He wrote this. Bud Light ad was a mistake of epic proportions. Oh, God. This guy is such a tragic accident. I'm going to try to get through this.
All right.
The Bud Light ad was a mistake of epic proportions. And for that.
You want me to read it?
And for that.
It's so ridiculous. Surreal. It's so, yes.
Could you read it? I don't know if I can pass the first line.
Sure. All right. The Bud Light ad was a mistake of epic proportions, and for that, a very big price was paid. But Anheuser-Busch is not a woke company. Can give you plenty that are. I'm building a list and might just release it for the world to see. World is capitalized. Why not? The radical left does it viciously to well-run conservative companies. So, you know, essentially, Donald J. Trump has now declared that Bud Light is back on the shelf. It should be okay now to drink Bud Light, to purchase Bud Light. And by the way, Anheuser-Busch has got a lot of money that Donald Trump wants to get a hold of some of.
That's
that.
That's right. And then political ads. And then he also has invested in Anheuser-Busch stock. So yeah, there are a few little things that you have to consider when you make these boycotts real. And I guess, apparently, according to Trump, again, it was a mistake of epic proportions. what is wrong with these people?
Well, he's a TV guy, you know. He's looking at the ads and he thinks, "Well, this is a good idea, really."
Just jump on a boycott. I think that's what it's all about. It's if you see one, get on the bandwagon, as it drives by.
There's more important issues to deal with.
Well, there is, and that is communicating with black voters. And Trump advisor Pastor Daryl Scott revealed that Charlie Kirk, and he's the CEO of Turning Point. They used to call it Turning Point USA. Now it's just Turning Point. It's a MAGA Republican organization with numerous chapters across the country. This pastor noticed that Charlie Kirk suggested that Trump make stuff up and lie to black people to win their votes.
Wait a minute.
Yeah, it's true. It's true. That was the suggestion? This really did happen. This is from a pastor. He noticed
to
it.
Lie?
He said, yeah.
Gee,
to
well, lie. I wonder how is he going to be able to do that? He's such a truth teller. Oh, boy.
Okay, and this pastor, Scott, who identified the comment as coming from Kirk, in replies, asked his followers if the comment means Kirk is a racist. Mm. Scott has been calling out Kirk as a racist after his attack on Martin Luther King Jr. and black pilots. Remember that controversy?
Oh, yeah.
If that pilot is black, would you trust them to fly the plane? who would have come up with that thought except for Charlie Kirk, who is, I would assume, a racist at this point? Amazing stuff. Right? I mean, you hear this. Yeah. Why doesn't it have national repercussions? Why isn't a story like this have giant proportional problems for the nominee for the Republican presidential race?
There's just so much out there. There's so many other stories. And yeah, even these smaller to medium-sized stories just get brushed to the side.
What do they call it? The fire hose of misinformation?
That's it. Yeah, there's just tons of it out
there. There is tons of it. Now, this is a story from a month back, but I think it's still relevant today. The MAGAs are now complaining that they really don't have any kind of agenda to promote in their campaign ads. they're noticing that they may have a problem here. It says here, it's embarrassing. Republicans worry that they have no achievements to run on in 2024. We have nothing, in my opinion. We have nothing, nothing. Not alone. GOP Representative Andy Biggs said on Newsmax that they do have a big problem.
We have nothing, in my opinion, we have nothing to go out there and campaign on, Chris. It's embarrassing.
Right. Well, I know the Republican Party in the Congress of the majority has zero accomplishments.
There you go. That's from Newsmax. We have nothing, nothing. Well, unless now you consider the invasion of our southern border. That, again, is something that they can run on. And as you know, the national temperature in regards to Bidenomics is improving. You know, the message is getting out there now.
Yes.
And so public support is starting to gather, and people are becoming more aware of how well the economy is running, even though individually they may not be affected by it, but they do know that in general the economy is getting so much better. So, you know, with that in mind, they have to pick on the southern border as their big issue. And if we have to listen to it again, we need to be reminded by Chip Roy from Texas.
One thing.
There we go.
I want my Republican colleagues to give me one thing, one, that I can go campaign on and say we did. One. Anybody sitting in the complex, if you want to come down to the floor and come explain to me one material, meaningful, significant thing the Republican majority has done besides, well, I guess it's not as bad as the Democrats.
Oh, yeah. Well, we got a phone call, too. This is a fantastic topic. They have not one thing, not one thing.
That's right. Dick is on the line here from Madison to chime in. Good morning, Dick.
Guys, I disagree. They got something to run on. Trump says he's going to run on it. The abortion, oh, wait a minute, that's not popular. You know,
no.
I read something about that cash cow went away, and they got kind of lawmakers' remorse, you'd call it, because it was a huge fundraiser. And then when it went away, and it's also unpopular, but do something on guns? No. Do something about the border? No. You know, there's all kinds of things that are popular they could do but won't do.
That's right, because, you know, this is something that they need to have at least, you know, rile up their voters, and all voters, actually. You know, if they make things bad, and this has been a big study, that when things are going poorly, people resort to voting for the conservative. They know this. This has been a proven fact in research. So when things are going poorly, they don't go to the liberals. They don't go for help from the government. They go to the conservative party, who is always bad-mouthing government as the cause of all of these issues. When in fact, well, I guess you could say it was the government. These guys are in government, and they're causing these issues to remain instead of solving the problems that are out there in society.
Well, the overturning of Roe v. Wade, though, that's hilarious in my mind.
Yeah. Yeah, and I still think that's one of the most important topics and the reason why people should vote.
Mm-hmm. All right. Dick, thanks for your call.
Dick,
608-879-8255. In fact, speaking on abortion, that abortion drug challenge based on pseudoscience and errors and propaganda, we've got that story, John, about the U.S. District Judge Matthew Kaczmarek.
Yeah.
He issued a ruling last year banning distribution of, is it mifepristone?
Mifepristone.
Mifepristone. Sorry.
Yep. And it's not a commonly referred to drug, but it is now because
it's the abortion pill.
It's one of the two pills they use. And you could still get the other pill, but this one they're trying to get off so the abortion pills aren't as effective. And it apparently has been proven to be not very good research. Sage Productions, which published this, they announced that it was retracting three articles that helped form the basis for Kaczmarek's conclusion. Two subject matter experts identified unqualified or incorrect factual assumptions in the research, material errors in the author's analysis, these are kind of big issues, and misleading presentations of the data that demonstrate a lack of scientific rigor and invalidate the author's conclusions in whole or in part. Get this, this is one of the biggest, weirdest things of this.
Okay.
Publications found that in the 2021 study that Judge Kaczmarek cited, all but one of the eight authors were affiliated with an anti-abortion advocacy organization. You think maybe that's a red flag? You think?
Yeah. That's crazy.
All of them except for one out of those eight. Oh. And despite having declared that they have no conflicts of interest, so they lied about that. Plus, a peer reviewer had been affiliated with one of those groups as well. So Sage Publishing ruled that Kaczmarek's findings essentially amounted to a conservative piece of propaganda. And now, will the Supreme Court, who is going to be hearing this case, are they going to hear this part of it? Are they going to hear that these studies have been withdrawn, basically, from publication? We'll hope.
You know, the Supreme Court's gotta have a busy agenda here coming. It just seems like every day there's one or two or three more things that they have to decide that are going up to the Supreme Court. How do they divvy all this work up?
I don't know.
They've got too much to do.
Well,
you know, they have a lot on their minds. They got to get the robes clean, send those out to the dry cleaners. You know, they have to get the gavels all polished up for all these judges' decisions. You know, they got pictures. They got plenty of things to do. Yeah. Usually, they don't have this much to do, but this election year, they've got way too much to do.
Well, anyway, they're going to hear this case next month. We hope that withdrawing these publications basically may have some influence, but it's just propaganda. I don't know. Again, we're dealing with a very, very right-wing court, and they're not afraid to flex their right-wing muscle.
That's right.
All right. Now this is. Do we have time here?
We have a couple of minutes.
Okay. All right. There's something in regards to using a women's rights bill to allow hate crimes against trans individuals.
Where is this going on?
This is going on in Georgia. In reality, the measure by Georgia GOP Republicans basically would expose women, both cis and transgender, and cis, is just your normal birth gender. That's what it means.
Okay.
But this affects both normal cis and transgender individuals to increase violence and discrimination. The Georgia House bill was introduced by a group of six Republican state representatives, five of whom, get this, are women. The bill has this in it. An individual's sex can be observed or clinically verified at or before birth, and in no case is an individual's sex determined by stipulation or self-identification. Here's another point. This would define transgender people out of the law, stripping them of many rights and protections. There's also a measure aimed at eliminating gender discrimination, such as ensuring equal pay or barring discriminatory hiring practices. So they could be discriminated against any time. According to this bill, they're allowing discrimination against transgender individuals.
We will continue that. And also, coming up, what's going on around Madison today? 7:49.
Mad Radio WMDX 92.7 FM at 1580 AM, broadcasting from State Street, Madison, right next to the Capitol, and that fever in the Capitol is bleeding over into our studio. Sometimes we just try to control ourselves when we read these crazy stories, like in Georgia.
Yeah,
the GOP. By the way, this thing that the GOP is planning, this bill, they call it a women's rights bill. It's hard to oppose a women's rights bill, right? So this thing basically is going to affect or allow individuals, transgender individuals, and even women to be discriminated against. And this is one point I want to mention before we move on to the next topic here. The measure also changes state criminal procedures so that attacks based on someone's sexual identity or gender no longer qualify as a hate crime. Trans people are over four times more likely than cis people to be victims of violent crime. If it becomes law, trans people could no longer seek legal recourse if they are attacked. And many of these measures passed in 2023 were aimed at banning gender-affirming care for trans and non-binary children, despite the fact that the medical community widely considers gender-affirming care to be life-saving treatment. They oppose that. In 2024, many Republicans have moved on to targeting trans adults now because, they were protecting the kids once, now they got to protect the adults from the adults. Mind like expansion right there.
Yeah, mind-boggling and craziness in Georgia. If you want to take a break from all the heavy news of the day, you know, locally, nationally, regionally, you know, why not consider Romance Under the Stars this evening, John? You know,
Okay. Wow.
It may
nice
be cloudy,
smooth
but
transition there.
I know I'm shifting the gears without the clutch, but it wouldn't be the first time, and it won't be the last.
Oh, I love
Romance Under the Stars, brought to you by the Madison Metropolitan School District Planetarium. That's right. If you're 18 and above, you are invited to explore the night sky at 6:45 this evening or 8 p.m., and this goes on at the planetarium. You can find out more online. Cardiac Arrest. Yes, that's the name of the show. It's songs about messy sides of love. This is happening at the Burr Oak this evening. Yeah. I might have to check this out. Music Theater of Madison Review with singers Robert Godrich, Scott Lewis, Abby Nichols, Megan Randolph, and Kat Richman, pianist Zach Bush. There is a charge for this. It's at the Burr Oak, and that's happening this evening. And the Winter Carnival continues at the UW Memorial Union today. Socially distanced outdoor activities happening at the Memorial Union area. And one more here, drinks for dogs. John, take your dog to the Brown Paws Dog Rescue. It's happening. The Underdog Pet Rescue happens in February at the Boneyard. It's a dollar donated for each drink sold to the Brown Paws Dog Rescue. And it's all for a great cause. Okay.
I've always all been right. kind of meaning to Fun go stuff. To the Boneyard, you know, just the because Boneyard. I like the name.
I know.
I just like to go in there for a beer and check it out. Why not? Dog's going crazy outside.
Just sounds going like crazy. A good time to me.
Yeah, yeah. My little Kraken would enjoy herself immensely, actually. we should
What's
have named
What's the dog's
her
name
Kraken.
Again? Power.
Power, yeah.
Yeah. It's How did after, you come up with that name?
Well, it's our first girl dog, and mm-hmm. we thought of girl power.
Okay.
And we just call her Power now.
Mm-hmm. And it's a puppy, right?
At 10 months old. It seems like she's been 10 months old for about a year now.
Okay.
But Anne continually reminds me, no, this is when she was born. This is, you know, she proves it each and every time. But I say, I swear, she's been 10 months for ages now. We have to move on. Once, you know, they get to that one-year mark. Things start leveling off emotionally for the dog, and summer was a tough time for her because when she sees other dogs, some dogs get overexcited and want to socialize with other dogs desperately and play with them and meet people, strangers, and scare a lot of people, you know, who don't like dogs. And she gets overexcited from all of the stimulation. So, you know, it's just something that, you know, we got to kind of, you know, temper a little bit this summer,
sure.
I think.
Yeah. Well, I love dogs. I haven't had a dog here for about a year and a half. I've been kind of looking around for another dog. That last dog was great. Rufus was with me for about 12 years. Loved to ride in the car. Just the perfect dog. Very mild-mannered and great with kids, and my grandkids loved him. But he passed on, about a year and a half ago. And I've been checking at the Humane Society and here and there. I think it's time to get another dog, but haven't found the right one yet. Just it's got to be a good fit, you know. And I like dogs that are a couple of years old, already house trained, and I just haven't found the right one yet.
Yeah,
you got to be careful. Yeah. You know, you got to pick the right one.
Well, yeah. you really do. But they always turn out somehow to be the right one, right?
Well,
you
know, I hope so. Yeah. Had pretty good luck over the years.
You have. Your last dog was something you bought from the Humane Society, right?
Well, actually, it was a rescue dog. And,
rescue
dog.
Okay.
Yeah, a preacher had it, and this was down in northern Indiana, and I went to visit and a couple of times, and I was like, boy, this is just the perfect dog.
Yeah.
Just so mild-mannered, and it was great. Yeah. But, anyway.
Well, some dogs have phobias, too, that you don't see right away.
Mm. Yeah? Are you a dog psychologist?
At a first glance.
Yeah.
No. Well, there is this great online dog course that you can sign up for and pay for, and it's a dog training course, and it is based on the psychology of a lot of these pets. Mm-hmm. But this woman is so fantastic at doing this It's stunning and bizarre. And you can even email. She has a podcast that she continues to do. So if you do email and you have a question about how to train your dog, if your dog has some kind of phobia, you know, or is gets too excited about one thing or another, starts ripping things up, you can always email and she may deal with it on a podcast.
That's a great idea.
Yeah, but she's very, very good. I can't think of her name, Susan something or other.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a great course. I'll pass it along as soon as I look it up.
All right, very good. Well, John, it's happened again. Somehow we have...
Well, we ran out of time.
We're out of time for today's show. Wow. But tomorrow, of course, Rocker will be stopping by and give us a preview of what's happening on his weekend show, Maximum Ink Show. So Rocker will be here. We want to thank our producer extraordinaire, Sam Davison, for pushing all the buttons and flipping all the switches just the right way for us. Thank you, Sam. John, we'll talk to you tomorrow morning, 6 a.m.
All right. We'll see you then.